It's a great pleasure to be back here, and they actually were generous enough to give me an honorary degree some years ago, and I think I've been back to give lectures and so on, but I'm beginning to lose track of it all. This is not the title of the talk. It's there because I rather like the way I did it, so I thought I'd have an excuse for showing you, and to see whether it fits onto the screen, which it doesn't quite, but perhaps that doesn't matter too much. I'll try not to lose things off the end. Anyway, it has to do with this title. That's what it's... The title is to do with seeing through the Big Bang into another world. I've given up putting the question mark at the end of that, so you'll see why I have the courage not to do that, perhaps, at the end. First of all, let me talk about the standard cosmologies. These were introduced by Alexander Friedman in 1922 and 1924, and my pictures will tend to be space-time diagrams, so you'll see time going up the page. So this means you have to think of time progressing as cross-sections of these pictures here. And these are pictures of the three original Friedman models of the universe. This is the Big Bang at the beginning here, and then the three different models here correspond to the three different spatial geometries. So you can have a closed-up one. It's nice to have these pictures, Escher's pictures and a model here, illustrating these three types of geometry. Here we have the sphere. You've got to imagine it's not just an ordinary sphere, but a three-dimensional sphere. Don't worry about the extra space dimension. That's not going to play a big role in what I want to say. That's the positive curvature case. That's the zero curvature case, the more familiar flat space Euclidean geometry. And this one, I want to say something a bit more about in a minute, but this is, for the moment, just to say these are the three possible uniform symmetrical spatial geometries, and in three dimensions you get the same three. And there's this thing called K, which is the curvature. This is positive curvature, greater than zero, equal to zero, and this is the negative curvature one. I'll describe this later, I'll come back to that one, because it's a very important geometry, not because I believe that the universe actually has negative spatial curvature. It may have. The observations seem to tell us it's pretty close to being flat, which is in a certain sense the worst case, because it could be slightly one way or slightly the other way, so we really don't know. But it doesn't matter for my talk. That's not going to be important. Now, these original models were where you have this thing lambda. Oh, I better keep this piece of paper here, otherwise you'll see those unsightly specks. Here we go. There's a thing called lambda, which is something that Einstein introduced in 1917, because he wanted to have a universe that was static. You see, this example of the universe as expands out from its Big Bang and then contracts back again. He wanted to have it also close up. So the only trouble with this model was that it had a Big Bang and it had what's called a big crunch. He would like to have this thing looking like a cylinder going up, which is all the same all the time. And he found that if he introduced this thing lambda, and if it was positive, lambda greater than zero, then there was a solution which didn't expand. However, shortly after that, Hubble discovered that the universe really was expanding, and so turned out to be not such a good idea, and Einstein considered the introduction of this thing called the cosmological constant to be his greatest mistake, I suppose, because if he hadn't done that, if he hadn't introduced it, he would have predicted that the universe would expand, you see, because then you can have a model which expands and maybe gets back again or keeps on expanding. When you have this lambda, though, you can have models other than the one that Einstein wanted, which seemed to be wrong, but you have other versions which do expand. And the thing about them is that unlike the cases here, where if the universe is spatially closed up, then it's temporally closed up as well. You see, it's only finite in duration. If it's spatially infinite, then it's temporally infinite as well. But that correspondence is destroyed when you have this lambda thing, and it keeps on accelerating in its expansion. Now, ever since this was introduced, it's in all the cosmology books, and I certainly learned it in the cosmology books, but people didn't, on the whole, expect there to be a lambda. However, you may have heard of the Nobel Prize that was given this year for physics for the discovery that the universe does do this expansion. You see, it starts to accelerate outwards in its expansion, which is an effect of the presence of this thing called lambda. And it was made out to be a great surprise when they saw this, which anybody who'd been reading most of the standard cosmology books wouldn't have necessarily been surprised by that. It's just, I suppose, the surprise is that there is a lambda as opposed to there not being a lambda, but it's already incorporated in Einstein's equations when the lambda's there. So lambda was something that Einstein originally considered was a mistake, but it turns out that even Einstein's big mistakes are also correct, at least this one was. Not everything he said was correct, but a lot of them were. And it does seem that the universe is one of these. Now, one thing about that is that you don't need to know so much about whether it's open or closed, you see, because all of them, at least if you have a sufficiently big lambda, which it is sufficiently big, they all of them do this exponential expansion in the future. It's what people refer to as dark energy, I think, to make it sound more mysterious. But you, from my point of view, it's just the lambda that I learned about when I first learned about cosmology. Anyway, it's what we seem to have is one of those models. So let me make sure I keep that piece of paper there, otherwise you see the specs. Let's tip this out, I think. There we go. So now I have a kind of generic picture of the universe. And it's generic because I'm not going to be bothered about whether it's open or closed at the back. Sometimes when I show this picture, people say, well, what's that big hole doing in the universe? But that's only because I don't want to imply that it's either open or closed. It doesn't matter for what I want to say. What I do require is that it has this kind of characteristic. A big bang at the beginning expands, and then it starts to accelerate. And we're somewhere around about here where this expansion, accelerated expansion, is beginning to make itself known. Now, some people who've read cosmology books might say, haven't I left something out? This thing called inflation. Well, I haven't left it out, or at least it's not there for two separate reasons. One reason is that if it were there, the picture would be exactly the same. You wouldn't even be able to see it. So let's try and see it. So we put a magnifying glass down there. And what do we see? Well, this is the magnifying glass, by the way, so don't be confused by it. That's the handle. What do we see? Well, we see something very like the ultimate expansion of the universe. So it's very similar. And people, for various reasons, suggested that there should, in the very, very early stages of the universe, oh, you get the specs back. I have to keep remembering not to take that piece of paper off. Very, very early stages of the universe. There's another thing which looked like the universe, but sort of tucked in there. Very strange idea. When I first heard that, I thought, that's a pretty crazy idea. Of course, crazy is pretty good in cosmology. If it's not crazy, it hasn't got much chance. But I thought that was a little too crazy. Anyway, so I didn't believe it. That's the other reason it's not in the picture, is because I'm not so keen on the idea. But we'll come back to talking about inflation shortly. But for the moment, let's talk about the other possible things that the universe might do. See, it might be that first example that we had here with the universe having a big bang and then this big crunch at the end. But perhaps it goes on like that and sort of starts there, and so I can just do it like that. And one of the reasons people suggested that is that the actual function that the radius of this universe is as a function of time is what's called a cycloid. So here we have time going up the picture, and if you imagine a hoop rolling on this vertical line, or rolling up like that, with one point marked on it, it traces out this curve called a cycloid. And a cycloid just keeps on going. Oh, here it's got a little spike here, but if you don't mind that, it just keeps on going. So it's natural to think, and people used to call this the oscillating model, it's natural to think perhaps that somehow the universe bounces and keeps on going like that. So that was the oscillating model, which came from Friedman's original considerations. Now, one objection to this, and Tolman, an American mathematical physicist, pointed out and tried to address, which is this thing called the second law of thermodynamics. We'll come back to that. Second law of thermodynamics tells you, roughly speaking, that the universe gets more and more random as time goes on. Well, I have a picture of it here. Perhaps I should just show you that. And people usually talk about the second law in terms of things like a glass of wine perched on the edge of a table. Here it falls off and smashes, and the wine gets absorbed into the carpet. Now, the thing about, let's just consider this as something happening in Newtonian mechanics. Now, Newtonian mechanics has these laws about, you know, first and second and third law and all that. It's a different second, it's not that second, of course. Newton's second law, and so on. Now, the thing about these laws is they're symmetrical in time. If you run the clock backwards, they work just as well as forwards. So that means that anything which happens consistently with Newton's equations in this direction could also happen the other way. So that could be the first thing, just a mess on the ground, and the wine gets sort of comes out of the carpet, jumps into the glass, which assembles itself miraculously and perches itself on the edge of the table. And that violates the second law. You see, the second law tells you something like randomness increases, and you don't expect to see it the other way. Well, I'll come back to that in a minute, but for the moment, let's see how Tolman tried to address this. He made a little bit more sophisticated model than Friedman had, in which there was a version of the second law, and then he found that this universe of his would have this, it wouldn't be exactly repeating, it would, these little phases would get bigger and bigger like this. Well, we'll see that that's actually a very primitive attempt at what the real problem is, which is a much more serious one. Various questions arise, which I don't think I want to go in here, but I just mention other people's names who have models here. Smolden has one where these new universes come out of black holes and things, and other ones which are, some of them a little bit like what I want to say, but not the same. So I just mention their names so you'll see it. I just say Veneziano is probably the closest to what I want to say. Okay. Let me go back to the second law then. Now there isn't, I've already shown you this, but let me bring it back. What does the second law say? Well, there's a thing called entropy, which is roughly speaking a measure of randomness. Now that's not such a good definition, and you can make it more precise. It's actually the logarithm of the number of possible sub-microscopic states which go up to make up the given macroscopic state. Let me not bother too much about the definition here. I have too many other things to say. But the entropy can be given a more precise definition than just, say, measure of randomness. And this has to do with counting states and so on, and then taking the logarithm of the number of them. The number of different states which look like this, the number of states which look like this, take the logarithm of that and you get the entropy, and that's supposed to go up. Okay, let me not worry too much about that, except to say that this progression is in a certain sense very natural. So if we know, now let me go to this picture at the bottom, here we have time going this way and entropy that way, and if that's now, then by far the most likely thing to happen is that this entropy will go up. And so from very general considerations, you can see that this is entropy increasing is by far the most likely thing to happen. Now, there's something a bit funny about that argument, because it really depends on how you ask the question. See, if you ask the question, if the universe started off like this, or if this room started off like that, then the most likely thing would be something like this. But if I ask you another question, that is, how did it get there in the first place? And then you see, well, there are far more ways it could have got starting in higher entropy and doing that than all the other possibilities. So it's much more likely, the most likely way it did that would be that it started as a mess on the ground and this assembled itself and the glass jumped up on the edge of the table. And that's obviously completely the wrong answer because it didn't do that. But it's what you predict using the same argument. So if that's all you know is what it's like now, and let's cover this bit up here, then you would expect prediction that it goes up in the future. And retrodiction, it ought to have been larger in the past too. And that's not what happened. What happened is the second law held before you looked at it, just as much as it held afterwards. Well, you shouldn't be able to determine something, to prove something time asymmetrical from laws which are completely time symmetrical. There's something fishy going on there. So there is something which has, in some sense, pulled this curve down in the past. Okay, what is it that pulled the curve down? Let's try and go back in our picture, and here's where this thing does come in useful. Here we go. You go back and back and back in time until you get to the Big Bang. So what it says is that if there was some reason that the universe started at a very, very small entropy, then that would be the explanation. As long as that is something you need to have, then from there on, this keeps going up. OK. okay, that's fine. But to ensure that the entropy continues to go down into the past, we need a huge constraint on the Big Bang. And I want to talk about what was the nature of this constraint. And what do we know about the Big Bang? Well, the most impressive piece of evidence about what the Big Bang was like, or its very existence, comes from this thing called the CMB, or the Cosmic Microwave Background. Well, CMB stands for Cosmic Microwave Background. And this is radiation which is coming at us from all directions. It was that also, all these things got the Nobel Prize. This got the Nobel Prize twice on two separate occasions, one for the original discovery and again for the things that I want to say in just a moment. One of these things has to do with, well, there are two things I want to say about this microwave background. First of all, it's ordinary electromagnetic radiation, so it's light, but it's light of a very low frequency. It corresponds to a temperature. Well, let me show you why it's a temperature. I'll show you this curve here. This is a curve which is one of the most impressive features of the cosmic microwave background. It was discovered sort of by accident by Penzias and Wilson, good enough to get them the Nobel Prize, though. And two things about it. One is this curve. This curve, well, let me tell you the other thing first. I'm not sure, perhaps I should tell you this first. Let me tell you this first. Okay. This is to do with the nature of the radiation. And here we have a curve which tells you these are frequencies, so this is as the frequency goes up. Here, the new thing here tells you the frequency. As the frequency goes up, you find the intensity starts by going up, and then it goes down again. And this curve here, the continuous line, is the very famous curve that Max Planck explained. It's his black body spectrum. This is what started off quantum mechanics. It was very important. Max Planck was able to explain the nature of this observed curve. However, none of the observed curves in the laboratory are nearly as precise as this one that we see here. Now, these bars here are error bars. So that tells you that there's a bit of error in the observations, and we don't know whether they're exactly on the curve. But what I should tell you is that these error bars are exaggerated by a factor of 500. So even the worst of them here, you have to make it 500 times smaller. And so you will see that those observational points hug that curve to well within the thickness of the incline. So we have an extraordinarily precise observation of this Planck curve. Now, what does it tell you? The important assumption that Max Planck put into his derivation, apart from quantum mechanics, which was to realize that his famous formula E equals H nu, that energy comes in little bundles, so that the light, or if you have a frequency nu, then, well, we'll come back to that shortly. But what it's telling you is that what you're looking at is what's called thermal equilibrium. Now, what's thermal equilibrium? It is a state of maximum entropy. So there's something fishy going on here. And I could never understand why cosmologists were not more puzzled by this than I always was, well, for quite a long time. It's telling you here, this picture is telling you that when you go back in time, you must find something of very, very small entropy. Yet, what this curve is telling you is that you've seen something of maximum entropy. And you don't have to be a very sophisticated mathematician to tell you that there's something fishy going on here, that when you accept something going down and down and down in the past, you shouldn't reach the maximum. That doesn't quite make sense. Well, I think people worry, well, the universe was pretty small in those days, and so perhaps there wasn't much room for much entropy. That's just wrong, because there's as many degrees of freedom when you work your way back in the past or in the future. That's just not the right answer. What is the right answer? Well, I'll show you what the right answer is. The right answer has to do with what you're looking at here. What are you looking at? You're looking at this radiation coming at you. Where does that come from? It comes from photons and charged particles in equilibrium. They're sort of churning around, and they are, yeah, this curve is telling you this is basically equilibrium. Okay, the universe is expanding as well. That is, Tolman himself was very clear to point out, that's not the point. Expansion doesn't make any difference. The answer is something quite different. The answer is in the other thing that I wanted to say about this black body radiation. That is that not only does it have this wonderful spectrum, but if you look all over the sky, the temperature, I should say that the spectrum has a particular shape depending on the temperature. And what you are looking at is something for the particular temperature, which is about 2.7 degrees above absolute zero. Very, very, very cold. And this is supposed to be, in a sense, the flash of the Big Bang you're looking at. Wasn't that very hot? Yes, it was, but the universe was expanding since then, and that expansion will cool down that extremely hot initial state you're looking at to something which is very close to absolute zero. But that's fine, we understand that. Okay, so you're looking at these photons and electrons indirectly in thermal equilibrium. What you're not looking at is the other thing, well, you're looking at it too, because the other thing I want to say about this cosmic microwave background is that it's uniform over the whole sky. If you look in that direction, and that direction, that direction, you see almost exactly the same temperature. Not quite, because we're moving through this radiation, and this means that the part we're moving into is just a little bit warmer, the part we're moving away from is just a little bit cooler. And that's one of the remarkable things about this. You can actually tell the Earth's motion through around the sun's motion around the galaxy, and the galaxy's motion within its cluster. So there are all sorts of motions adding together, and it fits very, very well. However, then, what you do is correct for that and say, okay, we know how to correct for that. We correct for the Earth's motion, and now you find uniform temperature over the whole sky to something like a part or so in 100,000. So one part in 10 to the 5. Very, very equal temperature all the way around. But not exactly equal, but very equal, which tells you that it's pretty well uniform, what you're looking at. And what does uniform mean? Well, let me tell you the one thing that's missing from that picture. The main thing that's missing is explained in this transparency here. Well, first of all, second law, entropy increases with time, and roughly speaking, entropy is disorder. If you have a gas in a box, which is the sort of thing that you would do, you're trying to explain to students about entropy, and let's suppose that it has initially cordoned off a little compartment in the corner there. You open up the compartment, and it spreads out over the box. And this spreading out to a greater uniformity is consistent with entropy increasing. Well, that's not going to do us any good because you see you're very uniform. So again, it looks like high entropy. However, this is not taking into account gravity. Suppose you take gravity into account. Now I'm going to picture not gas in a box. These are not now molecules in a box. They are some enormous galactic scale box. It's just a thought experiment. We don't need to build it. Don't worry. Anyway, these things are stars. And you see that when they are attracting each other gravitationally, there is this tendency for them to clump. And so they clump and clump and clump. So it looks as though it goes the other way. So what we're seeing is uniformity over the whole sky. That uniformity is consistent with the matter being in thermal equilibrium, consistent, therefore, with this picture, too. OK, that was thermal equilibrium. But what's not in thermal equilibrium is gravity. So that the gravity was the entropy was very low in gravity. It's the tendency to clump. I could say a lot more about that, but I have other things to say. So the main thing I want to talk about is this thing at the end here. What is the maximum entropy state that these gravitating bodies can achieve? Well, it's this thing called a black hole. So we're going to have to say something about black holes. Now, a black hole, I have a picture of a black hole. But it doesn't look like that. It looks like this. You see, because I told you I was going to show you a lot of space-time pictures, and you see it's too big to fix in here, but let's start. Here is some collapsing star, which got a bit too big for its the amount of, well, it's too big. Stars which are too large, say about several times the mass of the sun, will ultimately collapse down, and there's nothing can stop them. I don't want to go into all that, but that is the expectation that we have for very, very massive stars. And here I have a space-time picture. Now, I've got these little cone things all over the place, and they are the important thing that I want to talk about. What are those cones? Those are things called light cones, I suppose technically null cones, but I'll probably call them light cones. They are the most important aspect of space-time. Bear in mind, you see, this is really a four-dimensional picture, but I'm throwing one space dimension away, so think of it as a three-dimensional picture, two space and one time, just to picture it more easily. And the cone represents what light would do if there were a flash of light here. It would travel out with the local speed of light. Here we have a spatial picture, and the spatial picture I can try to indicate the other dimension too. But we have the flash, there it is in the middle. A little bit later, it's reached to this scale. A bit later still, it has reached to that scale. So we have this explosion coming out with the speed of light. And that's this represented in space-time terms by this cone. You have to imagine that this thing, which looks like a circle tilted, is really a sphere, but don't worry too much about the extra spatial dimension that's needed. Now, special relativity, that's where gravity is not incorporated. You have these cones all over the space-time, so this is really a four-dimensional picture, but three will do. Time going up here. And the important thing about this picture is that photons, particles of light, massless particles, will have world lines, that's the history of the photon, along the cones. So they're always going with the local light speed. Whereas a massive particle is supposed not to be traveling faster than light. And I ask you not to worry about these neutrinos, because that you may have heard of, which are supposed to be going faster than light. I'm sure there's something wrong with that experiment, but if there isn't, then we're a lot of people here are in trouble. But I don't know exactly what's wrong with it. It may be something to do with general relativity, for all I know. One of my colleagues thinks that they haven't got the special relativity right, but I have no idea myself. General relativity is very similar. You've got your space-time with these little cones. Imagined at every point you've got one of these cones. And what that's telling you is what the local speed of light is. You might have to draw them in funny ways, but if you happen to be sitting there, you would think time was sort of going that way. If you were sitting here, you'd think time was going sort of that way. And the rules are still the same, that any photon has its world line along the cones, and any massive particle must have its world line, its history, that is, within the cones. So it's always going less than the local speed of light. Okay, so there we are. We've got the light cones. We've got a black hole. And then you can imagine what you'd see. I don't need to worry too much about these things. The main two things about this picture I do want to worry about, though. First of all, this horizon, which is Jim actually mentioned about that, with this cosmic censorship business, that's telling you that what's going on inside the horizon can't get out. So light, because the cones are tipped over like this, think about this one, you see, light inside here can't get out because it's got to travel along the cones, and massive particles can't get either. They can get in, but they can't get out. So you see that it's the presence of this thing called the horizon, which is where the cones have an outer surface which is vertical in the picture. That horizon, the event horizon, is a horizon for events inside. It means what it says. But if a signal comes from here, it can't get out. It's going to go inwards. And inwards means that you hit this nasty thing in the middle, again, which Jim mentioned, the singularity, where space-time rules go haywire. We don't know in detail what happens. There are theories about what sort of crazy things happen to the space-time. It goes pretty wild, but it seems to be that that's the end. So if you are unfortunate enough to fall, or foolish enough to fall into this black hole, and that would be your fate to hit that nasty thing there. Okay, we've got the singularity, we've got the horizon, and this is the result of a collapse of some massive star. Okay, now I need to go back to my picture of the universe and try to put my black holes into it. So let's do that. Here we have my generic picture of the universe. And here we have making it a little bit more accurate by putting some black hole singularities in it. Now, the thing about this picture is it really does, you see, if you were, if somebody living in this universe here, your remote past would be the Big Bang. And if you, your ancestors or you or somebody fell into this black hole, then your future would be this singularity. Now, they are actually very different. in detailed structure. It used to be sort of said, well, you know, if you have one, you might have the other, and so they're more or less the same thing. But they are very different in structure. And basically, it's the entropy business. The entropy has gone up, and the black hole singularities are high entropy, and the Big Bang singularities are low entropy. Now, I have to find my picture of the, all the universes which I thought, oh, here we are, that's it. Keep them handy. So let me go back and fix up my original pictures by putting in some singularities. I can do that for all of them. There are the black hole singularities. Still the Big Bang isn't so much affected. But look at this one, you see. We've got a great mess, which is this congealing of all these black hole singularities. And that's what could have happened. You see, the entropy is going up and up and up and up. Black holes have enormous entropy. This is due to the, well, the Bekenstein-Hawking formula for black hole entropy tells us that the entropy in a black hole is absolutely huge. In fact, the by far the largest entropy in the universe as we know it is in black holes. It used to be thought that this cosmic microwave background had a lot of entropy in it, but it's utter, utter chicken feed compared with what we have in black holes. In our galaxy, for instance, we have a black hole from observations. It's pretty good evidence. You can see the stars. You actually could see them in the sense of mapping them out. I don't know how you can have a movie of them. Okay, one picture per week or something like that. But you can actually see the orbits of these things going around this central, something like 4 million times the mass of the sun, black hole, in the center of our galaxy. Okay, so that's a lot of entropy in these black holes. And here, when they congeal and to form this great mess, that's absolutely vast entropy. So yes, it's going up. It's not quite Tolman's picture, not at all like it, because he assumed the universe was very homogeneous. And that's the key difference. If the universe is irregular spatially, okay, it starts off pretty homogeneous, but after a while it clumps, and it's this clumping into black holes which gives you the enormous entropy increase. Now, I want to go back and talk about inflation, you see. Inflation was sort of introduced as an explanation for various things to do with why the universe is so uniform, and various things like that, why the temperatures are so equal in different directions. But it always worried me. It never seemed to me that was really could possibly be the explanation. Why not? Well, let's think of this universe going the other way. Let's suppose it has some irregularities in it. They will mount up like that first model I showed you, a Friedman model with its irregularities in it, and it will produce one horrendous mess, a thing that we call the Big Crunch, and that will be the kind of picture that we would get. Okay, nasty singularity at the end, but that's what we our equations will tell us will probably happen by a huge, when I say probably, by overwhelming probability. Okay, put inflation in it. Well, I've not told you how to do inflation. I'm a bit hazy on how you do it myself. But there is a thing called the inflaton field, which is supposed to do it. And the key thing about this is that like Newton's laws, it's equations which are completely symmetrical in time. So putting this inflaton field in it doesn't make any difference to this picture. The entropy still goes up. It doesn't help. It couldn't, because it's symmetrical in time. So if that was a much more likely endpoint for the universe, it was a much more likely beginning point for the universe. So it's not explained anything. Put inflation in, if you like. With a great mess like this, it doesn't actually work. So it doesn't explain why the universe has this uniformity. It seems to have, and it's a huge puzzle. See, you get the models with all those things like that, and well, I had the mess at the end. I could still put that on. If I'll go around chasing after all these things, that's the much more likely one, you see. But you see, why don't any of these have starting points like that? So that's a puzzle. And it always seemed to me it's one of the huge puzzles of cosmology, and I'd never understood why cosmologists hardly ever took it seriously. Very strange. A fundamental problem raised by the second law of thermodynamics and the nature of the Big Bang. Why did the Big Bang not involve any white holes? Well, I didn't say what a white hole is, but a white hole is a black hole turned upside down in time. And this is a much more likely, high entropy, much more likely initial singularity than not having that situation. So this is the big puzzle. Why did the Big Bang not involve any time-reverse black holes? A big mess like the ones I've been showing you here. It's not answered by inflation, nor by any current theory of quantum gravity, which is the sort of thing people try to bring in. They don't know what it is. I don't know what it is. Nobody knows what it is. But if it's a theory which is completely symmetrical in time, it doesn't seem to help. That's the big puzzle. Okay. Now, I've been worrying about that puzzle for a long time, and I thought, well, maybe there's an asymmetrical theory of quantum gravity which explains it or something. My views have somewhat shifted, and it's always a good thing, I suppose, to allow yourself to shift your views, so I can be sort of brag that I changed my mind about something. Okay, in order to understand this issue, let's go a little bit further with the black holes. So here we have something like the picture I had before, but let's look very far into the future. Now, according to Stephen Hawking, a black hole is not completely and utterly black. It has a slight temperature. To get some feeling for what that temperature is, think of the coldest temperature that's ever been made on the Earth, and then you ask for the hottest black hole that anybody has ever observed. They're sort of comparable temperatures. The bigger black holes are colder still. So it's very, very, very cold. Now, nevertheless, since this universe is doing this expansion, particularly this exponential expansion, which I keep showing you here, it cools down. Okay, we have this microwave background, which is about 3 degrees absolute now. It will go down and down and down. So no matter how big that black hole is, ultimately, the temperature will be less than that of the black hole, and that black hole will then be the hottest thing around. Not very hot, but not the coolest thing around, perhaps, but the hottest thing around. And when it's the hottest thing around, it will radiate. It will very, very slowly radiate. As it radiates energy, it will lose mass. Einstein's E equals mc squared, basically. It will lose mass. As it loses mass, it gets smaller. And it will get smaller, it gets hotter. And as it gets hotter, it starts to lose its mass a little more quickly. OK, not very quick if you're a very big black hole. And there are black holes even now known to be so big that the time for the Hawking evaporation of a black hole would be something like 10 to the 100 years. In other words, a Google years. That's, you know, write 1000 with 100 zeros. That's what sometimes is called a Google. So you have to think about that far into the future, something like a Google years, and the black holes will eventually all disappear with a pop. Now, I'm calling it a pop. You might think, why didn't I say bang? I'm not calling it a bang because, okay, you have to think of something like an artillery shell, something like that. But on the cosmological scale, that is pretty trivial. So although we have no idea what happens there, it's not much mass it's got to get rid of at that very end. Most of this is coming out, and it's photons almost entirely, and it's something that's pretty well understood. So I'm saying this is pretty well accepted. I'm not going to refute this or dispute this. I think that's indeed what will happen. And it's going to take an awful long time. But nevertheless, I've put it in my picture. Now, this is not to scale. You see, remember, there are Google years up here, and we're about here already, so it's not to scale. But the general idea is there. Notice I've said the very boring era up there. Well, the boring era is up here somewhere, where you have nothing left but black holes. And about the most boring thing I can think of is just sitting around waiting for a Google years for that black hole to go off pop. That's pretty much of an anticlimax. Now, I'm going to use an emotional argument here, you see, because I think that's perfectly all right to use emotional arguments in science, as long as you're prepared to, when you finish that, you do some serious work, see whether this emotional argument actually hangs together, and then you have to be very scientific from there on, you see. See if its observations confirm or refute it and that sort of thing. Okay, what's the emotional argument? The emotional argument is this boredom. It seems to me this beautiful universe we're in, all the wonderful things happening in it, and this is our fate. Just black holes, okay, got to think of them exciting now, even though it's only a pop. It might be quite interesting what's happening at the pop, but then they're all gone. Then what? Just in the universe thinning out and thinning out and thinning out and thinning out. Well, here's the rest of the emotional argument. Who's going to be around to be bored by this universe? Not us. Probably no sentient being, but maybe. Well, who's going to be around? Things like photons. And it's very hard to bore a photon. There are two good reasons for that. One is it probably doesn't have any experiences. Okay, that's good enough. But the better reason, at least from my point of view in this talk, is that photons don't experience the passage of time. Okay, what do I mean by that? Am I putting that on top of something important? I don't know. There are very, very good clocks in existence now. Atomic clocks, nuclear clocks, extraordinarily accurate clocks. Now, these clocks depend ultimately on even more precise clocks given to us in nature. Any stable particle of rest mass m, could be an electron, say, has two of the most famous formulae, well, most famous formulae of 20th century physics, Einstein's E equals mc squared, and Max Planck's E equals h nu. Now, the E is the energy, and between those two, you can eliminate the E, and therefore you find that this frequency is simply proportional to the mass. It's the mass times c squared over h. H is Planck's constant. But the frequency and the mass are basically equivalent. So any particle is a very, very precise clock. It's ticking away by itself with an extraordinary precision. OK, you can't build a clock just with one electron. You've got to do more complicated things. But ultimately, the reason you have good clocks comes down to the fact that these very fundamental laws of physics tell you that particles of mass, whatever it happens to be, are little clocks, just from these basic principles. Now, this tells us that we have a way of ultimately, I mean, general relativity depends on this, a way of physically defining clocks very well. And here we have clocks zipping along, and these little bowl-shaped surfaces, this is how relativity works, tell you where, if these are identical clocks, this is the first tick. You see all the different possible clocks going through that point with different speeds, you see. This will be their first tick, that's the second tick and the third tick. If you have light cones and clocks together, then you have Einstein's metric for his space-time. It's a thing that's often written G. It's got 10 components per point. Now, the thing I want to tell you is that if you only had 9 of them, and these 9, I'm going to say, are the light cone itself, without these little bowl-shaped surfaces, and then you've got ones hill-shaped ones going the other way, without those surfaces, just the light cones, that's what's called the conformal structure. Now, the conformal structure is basically angles locally, shapes, infinitesimal shapes, but not scale. So big and small are the same if you have conformal structure. The one extra number is giving you the scale. So Einstein's metric requires 10 numbers per point. If you only knew where the cones were, that is counts as 9 numbers per point, the extra one being the scale. So I want to distinguish then these two types of geometry. One is the Einstein geometry, which requires the metric. You have to know how clocks behave. That, remember my pictures? And I have to put this to get rid of my little specs again. Thought I should have stuck it down. Here we have these cones. That's not the whole story for Einstein. He would need the clocks too. So I'm putting on these little bowl surfaces. So if you have that, then Einstein has enough information to write down his equations. Well, he could write them down anyway, but to use the equations and to work out what physics is doing. But if you don't have those, that is what massless physics does. So photons don't have any mass. they don't have any way of building a clock. So you see, if you had a photon, it basically, think of it this way, it basically zips along the light cone, and it never even reaches the first tick, so it just goes along here. It doesn't know anything about time. So when I say it's pretty hard to bore a photon, the photon, from its initial production to the end of time, is no time at all for a photon. Just, and there it is, right at the end. So a photon's not going to be bored by that, because it's no time at all. Eternity is no big deal, if that's another way of putting it. So, okay. So I thought, well, that's it needs the not just the emotional argument, but it needs also the next step, which is to say, if you have a geometry which just uses these nine numbers, not the 10, just uses the nine numbers, that is conformal geometry, and you can have conformal space-time. I want to go back now to show you something you can do. Remember this picture? I'm going to not talk about that as though it was the spatial geometry of the universe, but it's just a description of what's called hyperbolic geometry. This is a picture due to the Dutch artist M.C. Escher. And the three examples I showed you before all used angels and devils, but put together in a subtly different way to illustrate these different kinds of geometry. Now this geometry, this is an infinite geometry, so you have an infinite number of, well, if they were drawn perfectly, an infinite number of angels and an infinite number of devils. And the infinity of this universe is this circular boundary. Now this is a representation of this entire infinite universe as a portion of the Euclidean plane. So it's sort of drawn on the Euclidean plane, but that is the whole infinite universe. And the key thing that I want to make use of here is that infinity itself is just a nice, smooth boundary. So if you are a kind of person, not one of these angels or devils, but a photon-like entity in this universe that has no way of measuring scale, then it wouldn't know where that boundary was. It could go zipping along and right over to, well, there isn't anything out here. But you could imagine that there was a continuation of this universe outside there, which, if there was no mass, so no way of building clocks, that this geometry would continue out into this unknown external region. And that is the idea that I want to explore. Okay, so the Escher picture is just a useful way of illustrating that. Now I'm going to think about it in space-time. Here we have the remote future, and if we have, this is a piece of mathematics which I'll just tell you, if you have this lambda, this thing referred to as dark energy, which is positive, then this infinite thing looks like in this picture. It's space-like. So it's sort of as though the universe comes to an abrupt end all at once. That's one way of thinking of it. But if you have just massless things, they don't care. They just go zipping right through from into this unknown region out there. Black holes are all gone. Matter collapses into black holes. The universe, the black holes disappear, disappear with pops and so on. Basically, photons and things like that are only thing left. Well, actually, I'm going to tell you something which is a slight issue here. You might have things with charge and rogue electrons which never get swallowed by black holes and so on. Now, here's where I'm going to make a bold statement, that in the four reaches of eternity, mass ultimately fades out. There's a technical reason for saying that's not such a bad idea when you have a cosmological constant. I won't go into that, but it's at least plausible. I need it. So I'm going to say that ultimately, and it could be even longer than these Google years and so on, mass itself starts to fade away. It's not the particles decay into massless ones, that mass finally decays away, and clocks then become impossible to build. And the geometry then becomes this conformal geometry, where it uses only the nine numbers, light cones, not the scaling that Einstein needs for his theory. Okay, that's all right. It's just a piece of mathematics, if you like. And you can certainly do this. This is a trick we've been doing for many decades, doing this sort of thing, just for technical mathematical reasons. Okay, now I want to go back to the Big Bang. That's the future. I haven't really talked about the Big Bang. Now I want to call, I think again Jim referred to the Weyl curvature hypothesis. I'm not going to tell you too much about it. I'm not even telling you in detail what the Weyl curvature is, except to show you what it is. I'll show you what it is, because you can actually see it. You can see it if you look. I don't know which is the best picture to use. Maybe that one. Okay. Here we have a picture of various galaxies, very distant ones, and there's a lot of mass hanging around here, and these are very distant galaxies, and you see that a lot of them are stretched out, and it looks as though there's rings like that. What you're looking at is what's called gravitational lensing, and this is a direct look at the Weyl curvature. The Weyl curvature is the conformal geometry of space-time. It's the conformal curvature of space-time. You don't need the metric. It's the part of the geometry which is just the light cones, and the distortion effect is something you can directly see. You're seeing gravitational field. You're seeing the field of this eternal thing. It's like with magnetism. You can see with iron filings. You can see the you can see the magnetic field, and here with gravitational lensing, you can see the gravitational field, and it is this lensing effect. Okay, that's all I'm going to say about the Weyl curvature at this point. And the hypothesis then is, see, in what way was the Big Bang special? Just as a hypothesis. Not why, but what. What was it like? Well, I'm saying it was that the gravitational degrees of freedom were not activated, that distortion that I was showing you in that previous slide was not present in the early universe, that there was no distortion in the no Weyl curvature present in the initial state. Now, that's sort of a nice thing to say for what the initial state might have been like, but mathematically it turns out to be a bit awkward, partly because the Weyl curvature is a complicated thing. It's a tensor, and to say a tensor is zero at a singularity is not a very nice thing mathematically. So my colleague Paul Todd in Oxford has a much nicer way of saying it. And his way of saying it, simply as a mathematical trick for formulating a nice version of the Weyl curvature hypothesis, is to say that this conformal geometry could be extended to something prior to the Big Bang. It's a hypothesis, but it's a nice hypothesis, nice mathematical statement, and it's a statement which encapsulates the very low gravitational entropy in the early universe. So that would explain, if we had a reason for believing that this extension took place, then that would tell us that that reason would give us the second law of thermodynamics in the form we see it. That was what I was starting. It's just a mathematical trick, and certainly Paul introduced this as a mathematical trick. However, you can see there's something physical about it too, because as you get closer to the Big Bang, for quite different reasons, mass becomes irrelevant. And this is because temperatures get so high. Okay, they get so high, bigger than the Higgs temperature, you know, what people are looking for at the LHC and so on. Bigger than that, higher temperatures than that, mass becomes irrelevant. There isn't any mass. So if there's no mass, you can't build clocks. If you can't build clocks, then the geometry of relevance is this conformal geometry. And Paul says a good condition to impose is that you can extend this conformal geometry to something before the Big Bang. Now, what are we going to do? What is there? I've got two little puzzles here. I've got before the Big Bang, and I've got after the remote future. Now, you might say, well, maybe like the early models I showed you with the bounces, that maybe this was a collapsing universe. But that doesn't help. Because if you had a collapsing universe, why wasn't it that great mess? And that great mess doesn't produce on the other side something that you can cope with. That doesn't work. Here's another idea. It's the remote future of what I'm calling an aeon prior to ours. That was the first transparency I had. This is our aeon. This is some aeon prior to ours. And if these fit smoothly, forget now the mass, we're only now looking at the conformal geometry, the 9 out of 10 components, you don't have the scale, then the hypothesis is that this continuation of the remote future of the previous aeon is now the Big Bang of ours. One nice thing, remember when I said rude things about inflation? Well, you see, that's because people think that inflation was something which took place just tiny amount after the Big Bang, tucked in here somewhere. But if it wasn't just after the Big Bang, suppose it was before the Big Bang. That's what this picture is saying. Okay, there was an exponential expansion. It's this picture in the previous eon. That's the idea. You could say, well, maybe that was us just before, and we go around in the circle. That doesn't work very well because you run into paradoxes if you're not careful. I'm not saying that. However, what I am saying is this. Here we have an infinite compression. That's this remote future squashed down to a finite surface, which you can do because we don't have clocks in the remote future, I'm proposing. And the Big Bang stretched out again to make a nice smooth initial surface. That's all right. That's just a piece of mathematics to formulate things. This one we pretty well know anyway. This one, well, that's a bit of a hypothesis, but it's a pretty plausible one considering the nature of this Big Bang. We need a way of constraining it. But here's the wild thought. This universe that we describe, that's my first picture, if you like, is but one, what I'm calling an aeon, in an infinite succession, maybe infinite, it could do all sorts of other things, but a continuing succession of aeons, where the remote future of each matches exactly to the Big Bang of the next through this conformal geometry. So as long as there's no mass hanging around just there, then this geometry works fine. Okay, you have to do this infinite rescaling, and it's a very strange idea. It takes a bit of getting used to, but nevertheless, that's the idea. Okay, now you might ask, what about the second law of thermodynamics? Surely we have the same problem again. If entropy is going up and up and up, how can you make a cyclic model make sense? Well, I'm not going to explain my answer in detail, but I'm going to say that the answer lies, how do you square the second law with this? The answer lies in something that Hawking said at one stage and then retracted many years later. I'm going to say Hawking was right the first time and that his retraction he shouldn't have made. That is that black holes, when they evaporate away, swallow information. And that is not something that physicists like on the whole. They think, well, information shouldn't get swallowed. However, you've got this nasty singularity, and we have no idea what happens when things ram into it. There's absolutely no reason why that information shouldn't get destroyed, and the evidence seems to be that it does, both from Hawking's initial arguments and from simple geometrical considerations, which I think are even more powerful than even the Hawking original argument. So I'm saying he was right. I agree with the young Hawking and disagree with the old Hawking. It's all right, you can take whichever view you want. You've got Hawking on your side, whichever way you do it. You've got to choose when, though, that's all. And the thing called phase space volume shrinks enormous. I won't go into all that, but the thing is that the zero of entropy gets reset every time a black hole disappears. It's not as though you violate the second law. You never violate it. It's just that you change your mind about what entropy meant. You change your mind about what the phase space is. Well, if you're a physicist, you know what a phase space is. Don't let me worry about that otherwise, but the idea is that it makes sense if the black holes swallow this enormous amount of information every time they grow and grow and then disappear with a pop. Okay, so that's the picture. Now, I've been telling you all this, but is it right? Well, like all physical theories, you should be able to test them against observation. So is there a way of testing this scheme against observation? Well, this seems to me the most plausible test. And this picture here, this is the surface, now I've drawn it in more dimensions, you see, this is the crossover between the previous eon to our eon. This is our eon, this is us up here. And in the previous eon, what was the most violent thing that you can think of, or that I could think of, which might perhaps get through from one side to the other? The most violent thing I could think of is now and again, within a cluster of galaxies, the black holes in their centers, the supermassive black holes, will collide. You see, we are apparently on a collision course with the Andromeda galaxy. Our cluster is quite a small one, but we have two big galaxies in it. Ours, the Milky Way galaxy and the Andromeda galaxy. And each one has a big black hole in its center, and we're going to have a collision with Andromeda. Okay, it may be the black holes will miss and go shooting out somewhere else, but after a while, the cluster will hang together more or less, and it may have another go and then another go. Ultimately, those black holes are going to run into each other. But they won't be a head-on collision. They'll probably go like this and get captured, spiral away, and then get caught, radiating away a bit of their energy in gravitational waves, and then swallow each other up. And then, when they swallow each other up, there will be one awful, wonderful, whatever way you like to say, explosion, carrying away, well, maybe a few percent of the total mass energy of those two black holes combined. Remember that ours, well, by then it might be several more million solar masses, and I don't know how big the one in Andromeda is, but it'll be one whacking explosion. What will that do? Well, these gravitational wave impulses will go out, hit the crossover surface, and have an effect which propagates over onto the other side. That requires some mathematics, which you have to go into fairly seriously to see what happens. But the upshot of it is that it doesn't come across on the other side as gravitational waves, but as a kick in the initial material, which is some form of dark matter. So this dark matter gets a kick when this wave hits it, and it moves it out in the direction of the wave, the initial impulse. And it's a bit like looking at a pond with little drops of rain hitting that pond. Each one is the analog of one of these impulses here, and then the ripple will get out to a certain point. And let's suppose the rain stops, and that corresponds to this place here where you're looking at the crossover, and you have a photograph of what that pond looks like. And the question is, can you tell whether that mess of ripples in the pond is caused by individual impacts of raindrops? And that's the statistical problem that, well, several years ago I confronted people at Princeton. They had a go at this, and the upshot of it is that they didn't see anything. Somewhat later, a colleague, Vahid Gurzajan, who's an Armenian, whom I'd known for some other reason before, I put this to him, really looking at it. I was wondering whether gravitational, you know, the effects like this might be spoiling the looks of those ripples and so on. And he was an expert on that sort of thing. But he came up with something quite different. He didn't look for what I was expecting originally, was that you see little ripples of slightly raised or lower temperature. He was looking at places where the variation in temperature around the ring that you're looking at is lower than in other places. And he came, it's about nearly a year and a half ago now, and he'd been doing some preliminary tests at this, and he said, we've got something quite interesting, he thought. And the way he was doing it is looking at various points in the sky and taking them as centers of these possible circles. So we're thinking about these ripples, you see, and you're looking at centers, and then you do look at rings bigger and bigger and bigger to see whether you can see evidence of that ring there. And that means low temperature variance, but let's not worry about what that means in detail. And he said, yes, he showed me some pictures, and he said, yes, I see a few of these, fixing the center and then increasing the radius. And I said to him, if you're doing it that way, do you see that with one center, you see more than one ring? And he said, yeah, that's exactly what I see. Why do I say you should see that? Well, you see here is one event, the same black hole, or another one in the same cluster, it doesn't make much difference, will happen again. It'll happen again and again and again as these black holes ultimately swallow each other up until they form one big one right in the middle. And then each time there will be this impulse coming out. And what will that look like to us? It will look like ripples, circular ripples like this, more or less an impulsive ring, but concentric. So you should see more than one with the same center. And that was the thing I found most impressive about what he'd done. Now, I had no idea about how you do the statistics of these things, but we wrote a little note on this and got a lot of complaints from people. I should say this is the microwave background, if you want to see what it looks like. It's all in there. I'm not quite sure whether I have it that way up or this way up, but whichever way up it is. I think it's probably that way up. It's all in there. So it's a question of how you look at it. You see, those are the ripples on the pond. Can you see where the centers are? That's the puzzle. And the way we originally did it, so we had lots of complaints saying, well, you should have taken this thing called the power spectrum into it. And he says, no, you shouldn't, because the whole thing's circular and so on. I'm not going to go into the arguments there. He does it now the way everybody else does it. But there's a problem with a thing like this, because people don't believe you at first. OK, these are the pictures he has where you look for at least three rings with the same center. Three, four, five rings with the same center. These are the centers that he finds, and he finds 352 centers. I should say that he's leaving out a strip like this which covers the galactic plane. So this is where our galaxy is. That's the galactic north, the galactic south. I don't know which way the galaxy is, I'm afraid, but which way there is, somebody here might know. But you're looking at the north and the south of the galactic plane, and this is the north, that's the south. And these are the centers, and these are the actual rings. So if we're right, these are events in the previous aeon which were collisions between black holes. The color corresponds to the temperature. Now, red actually means higher temperature, which for a physicist is the wrong way around, but never mind. The red ones are the hotter ones. And they're hotter, in my picture, because the impulse is coming towards us. So the kick in this material is in our direction. And so it looks slightly warmer. If the kick's in the opposite direction, it's slightly cooler. And so here you have, apparently, lots and lots of centers all crowded together. And they're, on the whole, rather red. There are other ones which are rather blue. I don't know how well the colors show up. I think you can see them there. And then, to test this, he uses these things called simulations, where you try to put random data in. And that's where the arguments always come, you know, whether you've done them right and so on. But he tends to find roughly 15 centers, whereas the real data, you see 352 centers. Another point is that the random ones, they look pretty random, and the circles are pretty small. Whereas the real data is very non-random, huge concentrations in various places, and circles can get pretty big. Not too big. If they get too big, then the theory's in trouble. It's all right. They don't get that big. If you saw one about that big, that would the theory be a bit in trouble. But you see them almost that big, you see them about this big. So it's quite impressive there. What about four rings? Even more, the distribution is extremely inhomogeneous. Great concentration down there. Very distant, because in the color coding they look red. That means cool, red or yellow. The other ones you see a few, which are, tend to be blue, which means red means warm. Red means warm. That means distant. So according to this theory, that's a very, very distant collection of stuff out there. According to the theory, these things are relatively close, pretty far off, nevertheless. And when you look at four rings, in the simulations, you tend not to see any at all. One or two, maybe, but on the whole, not any at all. I want to tell you something else, which... See, we sent a paper on this. We had a lot of trouble with referees. We sent a paper to the Royal Society a few months ago, and we got two referees said, well, look, we'd like some more explanation on this and this. And then the other referee was very rude and complained about these things and said what we ought to have used is not this mask, you see. This is a pretty crude mask where you're cutting right across the middle. You ought to have used this thing called the KQ85 mask. Now, I'd never heard of that before, but the KQ85 mask. And then what you find is that these big collection of centers that you can see here, for instance, curiously sit very much on a region. You see the pink thing here are things that you shouldn't look at and think it's cosmological. They say, no, it's probably some nearby thing because the radiation doesn't have the right spectrum. So you should cut all these bits out. And that's the more sophisticated thing to do. But then I was looking at these things, I'm very curious that that spot happens to be just on top of this real continent. What's this island doing anyway? Now I'm going to tell you something which has not yet appeared in print. And it's even wilder, perhaps, than the things I've been saying up to this point. Nevertheless, this coincidence did strike me. First of all, I thought, well, you know, that can't be any reason for that in this theory. And then I thought for a bit, maybe there is. Now you see here I've got two pictures. Here these are the cool rings where you've got, so this is us looking over here, somebody looking back at this. This is our past light cone hitting this initial surface. This is the Big Bang and the infinity of the previous eon. Those are these events, lots of these waves coming out. And if it's a close one, which would be relatively close, not very close, relatively close one, then those are the ones colored blue in the picture. If it's a relatively distant one, they'd be the ones that look red in the picture. In fact, yeah, that's right, these are the warmer ones, that's right, they're coming towards us. And then this light cone, actually can be extended back until you see this cluster of galaxies. So maybe we're actually seeing it. So here is the wild suggestion, is that the reason people have left out that, see this referee is saying we shouldn't use this mask, that you should leave out those points, and if you leave out those points then it kind of cuts out a lot of these ones here, that's the argument. But that doesn't have anything to do with it, because you're looking for circles, you're looking at the circles right here, they're not down there. So it shouldn't be a problem to put these in. I think he shouldn't have even cut the middle out. I think he should be looking at all that too. But still, that's what he's looked at so far. And the striking thing is that there seems to be something going on which is a bit funny that we're seeing directly. Photons coming directly. So the question is here, can we actually see through to the previous eon? Not just the black hole collisions and so on, waves coming from that, but the actual cluster itself. Maybe it's the light, sunlight, starlight from it, maybe it's the all sorts of things, got supernovae bursts, maybe it's even the Hawking evaporation from decaying black holes. Okay, it's a ridiculously small temperature, but you've got to squash that all into it, all that infinite period of time into a very small region in this picture. I've no idea, I haven't worked these things out, but it does seem to me quite remarkable, this coincidence. And is that telling us that some of these little points that people like to cut out, in fact, see that some of these also correspond, and that one certainly corresponds to a region. I'm afraid my pictures aren't all to scale here, but what you find is that one of the other reddest regions, you see the red regions are the cool ones. So the red regions are the hot ones, and therefore the distant ones. There's something going on here as well as here. And that seems to be just where this point is too. So is that what we're seeing? I don't know. At least it's something worth exploring. I think I've run out of my time. I was going to show some equations, but I have a feeling that I've run out of time and I shouldn't do that.